Well, how many people are happy this afternoon by a show of hands? To give glory to God. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah, I thank God for this opportunity for us to share according to His grace. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah. So this afternoon, I shall speak about the promised land. Praise God.
Amen.
The promised land. What is a promised land? Promised land means that there is a land that has been promised by somebody. Amen?
Amen.
A promised land means that there is a land that has been promised. Now, to a child of God, what happens when God gives you a promise? Number one, it shows that God must have spoken unto you. For you to hear of that, Lord, for you to know about that, there must have been a conversation. That is where, when or whereby a knowledge of a promised thing is delivered unto us. Praise Jesus.
Amen.
So, this afternoon we shall share about the promised land. And for the sake of our topic today, it speaks about the promises of God unto our lives as the children of God. What does it take for you to reach the promised land? What is your effort for you to reach that land which God has promised unto you? What does it take for you to attain a new thing that God has promised you? Bwana asifiwe. One time, our pastor alikuja hapa akatuambia that God gives him direction. Mungu anamwambia nataka ufanye jambo fulani. But I remember one thing that he insisted. He said that in most cases, God speaks to him that do this, which means there is a promised land. God shows him this, but what he always says is that God never gives details. One has it here. So in most cases, as a child of God, God may give you a promised land. God may show you something, but in most cases, don't expect details. One has it here. That is where our faith comes in. That is where our foundation in Christ is under a test of time. Bwana asifiwe. If God gives you a promise that maybe in future you'll be used in this and this ministry, will you believe? Number one, it takes to what you believe, what we have just been told here, your expectation. If you expect that thing to be manifested in your life, then you have to move to that promised land by faith. Praise God. What does it take? It is only by faith and belief. Praise Jesus. Psalm 105. Let us go to the book of Psalm 105. Are you there? Psalm 105. The book of Psalms, chapter 105. We shall start from verse 9. Psalm 105 from verse 9. The Bible says, the covenant which he made with Abraham and his oath to Isaac and confirmed it to Jacob for a statute to Israel as an everlasting covenant, saying, to you I will give the land of Canaan as the allotment of your inheritance. 12. When they were few in number, indeed very few, and strangers in it, when they went from one nation to another, from one kingdom to another people, he permitted no one to do them wrong. Yes, he rebuked kings for their sakes, saying, Do not touch my anointed ones, and do my prophets no harm. 16. Moreover, he called for a famine in the land. He destroyed all the provision of bread. 17. He sent a man before them, Joseph, who was sold as a slave. Praise God.
Amen.
Amen. As you can see in this scripture, David was referring to the promise that God gave to the children of Israel. It started from their fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He spoke twice and confirmed it. But as you can see here, God never gave them details about their voyage, about the promised land. These people lived by promise. Maybe when Abraham was given that promise, he believed that he would see that land in his time. But again, it passed in that generation. It went unto his son Isaac. Maybe Isaac also, knowing the promise of God, believed in it and knew that he would see that land. But again, it was passed to the next generation of Jacob. Praise God. Maybe even after him, he believed that he would see that land. But as we read the Bible well, we see that it was now moved to the generation of his children. That is from where they now inherited the promised land. But what did it take for them to inherit the promised land? One has appeared. God gave them the promise with no details. They only believed by faith. But what we see here is that God was working behind curtains. As we've read in verse 17, the last verse that we've read, we've seen that after God showing them the promised land is a promise, after speaking it, reconfirming it again, he sent a man before them. Born as a fear. And the children of Israel believed in God, so should we as the children of God. Whenever God has given us a promise, whether it is ministry-wise, individual-wise, you have to know that there is nothing you can do to reach that promised land. Because the Bible says that he who started that good thing in you is the one who shall finish it surely. Amen?
Amen.
The Bible also says that he who is the author of our faith is the same finisher of our faith. Born as a hero.
Amen.
Maybe Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, if they had gone with their minds, they could have started their journey to the land of Canaan immediately. But because God was not in it at that time, there's no way that they could have started it. That is one principle that we have to know about the promised land. What does it take? Principle number one is the appointed time. One has a fear. In your journey to the promised land, there is an appointed time. You can't go before God, but you have to wait for the appointed time. When our Lord Jesus Christ was going to heaven, when he was being airlifted to heaven, supernaturally, he gave a promise to the disciples. And they asked him that, you promised to us that you will restore the kingdom unto Israel. Will you do it now or when will you do it? But Lord Jesus Christ replied to them that it is not for you to know the appointed, the times and season that God has put in his own authority. Praise God. That is in Acts chapter 1 verse 7-8. So we have to know that in our journey to the promised land, there is the appointed time which is only managed by God. Born as a fear. That appointed time is in God's timetable. You may pray for things that God has promised you. Yes, it may come to pass. You may press on, but it will only come to pass at the appointed time. Born as a fear. God had promised these people of the promised land. But they had to wait for the appointed time that they would start their voyage there. How did God manage this? We see that after some time, God sent a man before them. God made a situation whereby he had to send a messenger before these people who will lead them in the right path to their promised land. And the man here was Joseph. God created a situation whereby he was hated by his brethren. He was cast as a slave, sold unto Egypt. But as he feared. And he being sent there as a man before them, in him he never knew that he would be a messenger or a messiah of the Israel, of the tribe of Israel. Praise God. I believe that in him he knew that he mapito and apitia the ups and downs of life. But in him still he believed in God. So what happened when God took him to that land of Egypt? He prepared him there as a messiah of his people, as a man who had gone before these people so that they would inherit the promised land. In a way, he was also being nurtured and brought up ready for the mission that God had preordained for him. Amen. And we see afterwards that even after he went there, God Father made a situation. He created famine in the land where Jacob dwelt, so that this family of Jacob would also move again to Egypt, where he had sent a man before them. Praise God. Amen. In your life, for you to get to your promised land, there are people whom God has ordained that they will lead you there. Amen?
Amen.
God sends a man before you. Even though God may have spoken in your life that you'll be a pastor, you'll be a prophet, you'll be a teacher, or an apostle, there is always a man that God has stationed to uplift you to that land. Praise God. A servant cannot be greater than his master. We see even in the case of Jesus Christ, he was the Messiah, he knew his mission, but before he was manifested fully in his mission, there was a man, John the Baptist, who was sent before him. Amen? That is the protocol that we have to know. There is always an appointed time, and there is a Messiah that is sent before you to achieve that ministry. Praise God.
Amen.
It is important for us as the children of God. At times, we have to pray as we go before God. We have to pray for our destiny helpers. We have to pray for our intercessors, because God has put those people there to intercede for you so that you may reach the heights that God preordained for you. Amen. So after God makes these situations, these people were itipata in Egypt, not in their liking, but because of famine. And again, after they had been in Egypt, God saw that you have been in Egypt for a long time. It's now time that you have to move here and start your journey to the promised land. But remember that all these people were in their comfort zones. There's no way that they will start to move to the promised land, yet they were in their comfort zones. Jacob was in his dwelling place. Famine came so that they would move. In Egypt, they were also in slavery, which it ignited their spirits to desire to move out of that path to their promised land. Praise God. At times, God may release hard times in your life. God may release situations that may press you down in your lives with an intention of making you rise to the next level, making you rise towards your promised land. Praise God.
Amen.
The Bible says that we cannot do anything without you. Yes, it needs God to act in your life so that you may move higher. Praise God. In your life, unahitaji mtu mwenye atakufinyilia so that you step up in prayers for you to get your deliverance. Praise God. Otherwise, if you are your own boss, there's no way you'll see the need of deliverance. If you're not hungry, there's no way you'll desire that food. Praise God. God must release that hunger in your life so that you may desire that food and work towards it. Even if it's going to buy it, you'll rise on your feet to go and buy it. Amen. So God makes a way. When He promises something in your life, He always makes a way. In His appointed time, He rises a destiny helper, a deliverer, for the sake, so that He will lead you to that promised land. And this involves test. There is the Messiah who has been sent to deliver, and then there are these people who are being led to the promised land. All of them are experiencing tests. One has healed. But the intention of God is that we all reach the promised land. One has healed. Let us look at the book of 1 Samuel. The book of 1 Samuel. The book of 1 Samuel, chapter 17. Here was a case of the children of Israel. God wanted to give them possession and wealth. God wanted to give them deliverance. God wanted to show His power through these people of Israel. That was the divine purpose of God. God had given them a promise that they were a chosen nation and there will be no nation that will stand before them. One has appeared. We can see this, that it's confirmed in the book of Joshua chapter 1. God had given Moses a promise that no one would be able to stand before them as the children of Israel. And it was reconfirmed again to Joshua at that time, that as I stood with Moses, my servant, I will also go with you. That was the promise of God. There was to be no opposition. There was to be no greater nation than the tribe of Israel, the nation of Israel. But it reached a point here whereby the children of Israel developed fear to some extent. Maybe they were in their comfort zones. Mungu maybe alikuwa amebariki in a flock with peace and everything. Maybe they were only experiencing small oppositions and they were in their comfort zones. But as a result of that, God had desired that these people should move in the power of God to gain the supremacy that God had given unto them. They were reluctant to move to that higher level. But here comes a situation whereby God creates a situation which will give them unrest. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 4. The Bible says, "And a champion went out from the camp of the Philistines, named Goliath from Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a bronze helmet on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail, and the weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze. And he had a bronze armor on his legs and a bronze javelin between his shoulders. 7. Now the stub of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his iron spearhead weighed 600 shekels. A shield bearer went before him." Verse 8. "Then he stood and cried out to the armies of Israel and said to them, 'Why have you come out to line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine, and you the servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves and let him come down to me.'" Praise God. As you see, it came to a point whereby for these people to trust in God, for these people to rise higher, God raised a champion in the camp of the Philistine who was very fiery. He was told that our Pastor Thomas here, because by this description, I believe he was somebody who was very tall, masculine, ungemuona ungekibia. But we see here that this champion went out of the camp of the Philistines and told them that if there is anybody who is man enough, let him come and battle me. Bwana asifiwe.
Amen.
Yes, at times God can release a champion to torment you. God can release a champion to intimidate you so that you can rise higher. Because if that opposition is not there, you'll be in your comfort zone and you will not reach your promised land. Amen?
Amen.
How many people want an opposing champion in the camp of their enemies? How many people? Only one person, only two people. Bwana asifiwe. There must be an opposing power to make you rise or jump higher to your feet. This man went out of that camp and he was defying even the gods of Israel. What was he saying? That in this day I stand even to defy all the God of the armies of Israel. And these people were in terror. Bwana asifiwe. And God knew it. God knows the end from the beginning. God knew that these people are in terror. These people are fear. Are in fear. They fear their opponent. And God knew it. And God was now making a plan behind the curtains. How will these people reach the promised land? Even Saul the king was there. But he also feared even to go and fight there. Instead, he was asking his people around, who will go? Nobody was ready. He gave them big promises, even to the ownership of his kingdom. But there was no man who was ready even to take that prize. Bwana asifiwe. Things may be hard in your ministry. Things may be hard in your calling, to a point whereby you say, if ni wokovu na achiabo, or maybe I'll go and be a backbencher. No, you don't have to give up. Why? Because God has sent a deliverer. God has sent a man who is going before you. He's walking behind the curtains so that you may reach your promised land. Amen?
Amen.
In every situation that you are in your calling, always know that you are not alone. Elisha was speaking to his servant when he was in fear, when he saw the armies that had gathered against them. But he only responded by saying that, be of good cheer, because them that are for us are numerous than those that are against us. Amen?
Amen.
When God has called you, do not fear. It doesn't take any of your efforts to start walking the promised land. All you have to do is to believe that he who started that thing, he who has promised that promise, will surely fulfill it. And he has raised people who will uphold you. He has raised people or a person who has went before you to ensure that you reach your promised land. Amen?
Amen.
God doesn't start anything that will defeat him. Before God initiates anything, he first looks to its end. I believe that as you are here today, God had made your place in heaven before he called you. Praise Jesus. God never called you to salvation with the intention that you will go to hell. Before he calls you, he knows that he has prepared a place for you. Praise God. Jesus said that no one comes to me unless the Father brings him to me. And again, he said that I am going to my Father's house and there are many mansions. I'm going to prepare for it, then I shall come and take you. So you have to be of good courage. You have to encourage yourself before God and say that because you inherited this in me, I know that you are surely making it come to pass. Amen?
Amen.
You can see in verse 11, the Bible says that when Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. When you go to verse 12, you see that here was David, a young boy in whom God had prepared to ensure that these people reach their victory. These people reach the supremacy that God had preordained for them. And you see here, I shall not read all verses because of time. Verse 14, what does the Bible say? David was the youngest. And David was the youngest, and the three oldest followed Saul. So you can see that David was a man who was sent to deliver Israel. A man was sent before. God was preparing him in the wilderness. God was ministering unto him, filling him with his power behind the curtains. Even the king never knew about this. His brothers never knew about this. He was alone in the wilderness, looking after the flock of his father's sheep. God was nurturing him, preparing him for this appointed time that will come. No one knew about this. And we can confirm as we read down, we'll see that when he surfaced and he gave himself up, he said that, I will go and challenge this man who is challenging our God. Even the king doubted. But because he had no choice, there's no way he will stop him. One has appeared. Intimidation was around there. We can see that David was moving. If you read this story, David was moving from one soldier to another, asking them, what has the king said that will be rewarded to the person who will fight the champion in the opposite camp? They told him the promises, but half-heartedly. Why? Because he was a young boy who was not experienced in matters of war. Praise God. Your deliverer, the man who has been sent before you, maybe a Sunday school child whom you may be seeing here and despising, not knowingly that he's the one who has been sent before you. Praise God. Amen. The person who is your destiny helper, who will ensure that you get your promised land, may be that usher in whom you despise because you are the pastor of that church. Praise God. It may be that brother with whom you envy because he is maybe of a lower standard than you, or maybe God is using him in a ministry that you're not being used into. Praise God. We are told here in the morning that judge not. I believe that you may judge that person who is your destiny helper, and when you kick him or her out of your life is done. One has failed. I was with another brother some time back, and I'll go and bear a testimony of his life. So he was speaking to me saying that kulikuwa na mtu fulani alikuja near him. So mtu alikuwa ako 50-50, hajashika Mungu sana, na ni mtu kama alikuwa mtu kama anamsumbua to some extent. Acha nitumie word, maybe it was like a burden to him. So anaona huyu mtu ni kama ako attached na yeye ndio, but huyu mtu ni kama is just a parasite or just mtu mwenye ako hapo. Paka alikuwa anashangaa, what do I do? He reached a point in his life paka akasema, huyu mtu, I love to distance myself from this person. But according to his experience, he told me that God spoke to him and told him, don't dare separate yourself from that person. He never knew why. Kumbe Mungu alikuwa ameorganize that these people be attacked so that he can tap something. This person may help him to get to his promised land. One has healed. From that I learned that you should not despise even that neighbor of yours who may not be saved as at this time. You may be seeing yourself as holy than thou, but you never know. That person whom you may be despising may be your destiny helper. Praise God. So we see here was David. God had raised David. And the appointed time had come. When he went there, alikuwa mpelekea ndugu zake vyakula ili awaone. Then he saw the champion. And when you read here, I was surprised here in 16, verse 16. The Bible says that, and the Philistine drew near and presented himself 40 days, morning and evening. You can imagine, the whole man, the champion comes in the morning. He calls upon you. Is there a man who can fight me? He waits maybe for an hour or 2 hours. Nobody. He goes back to the camp. Again in the evening, the same thing. For 40 days. Just imagine that. It is a situation that is tormenting you for a longer time. And I believe that for all the period of time, the 40 days, David had never come to see his brothers. Praise God. And maybe if he had come, maybe I'd wanna kuja mchana at the time when the champion, I'm reading the camp, because the Bible says he used to come early in the morning and also in the evening. But here was the appointed time. Why is it that when David came, he only came at that time when the champion was now speaking and defying the gods of Israel? Praise God. An appointed time is coming to your life. Amen.
Amen.
An appointed time is coming to your ministry.
Amen.
If you believe in God, an appointed time is coming for your promotion.
Amen.
An appointed time is coming for your job. An appointed time is coming for your marriage. Praise God.
Amen.
There is an appointed time for everything. Here was the appointed time when David had now come. When the appointed time comes, that person who has been interceding behind curtains, we will meet. And when you will meet, the breakthrough will surely surface. Praise God. I can use an example that has been said kwa hii pulpit. There's a day that a man of God was preaching here, and he spoke of a revelation that God gave to him. And if I can remember very well, he said that he seen a number of people. If I can remember very well, he said like two, like a couple or something like that, that they're interceding for this ministry. Praise God. And in him, he said that he has not been given a revelation of who those people are, but he's seen them, they're interceding for this ministry. One as if you. But I believe that that appointed time will come. Maybe God will make those people, he will cause them maybe to come and meet maybe our pastor or to visit us in this church, and that elevation will come. Praise God. When the appointed time comes, it's the point whereby your destiny helper, your intercessor, the man who was sent before you, comes in contact with you, and then the power is ignited in you. What has he feel? Joseph was sent before the children of Israel, but the appointed time had not come until the time when they went to Egypt. When they came in contact with Joseph, that is when the power of God, the power of voyage, started in their life. Amen?
Amen.
That helper may have been your pastor. Maybe you have been going to other churches, umekuwa na maktaibu. But the moment that you came to this church, maybe you have seen your life. I've been here for half a year, but this and this have changed in my life. Are there such people in this ministry? Praise God. I am one of them. Because I thank God that from the time that I joined this ministry in 2013, I've seen so many things in my life. And I believe that there is a destiny helper that was sent before me in this ministry. One has appeared. What does it take? I shall go a stray kidogo to the life of that man who is sent before you, for you to know what it takes for you to reach your promised land. You may be seeing that he's just an intercessor. Yes, he's just a pastor somewhere. He's a brother somewhere that God has put that thing in you. What does this man or this intercessor go through for you to reach that promised land? One has fear. For God to use you, for God to entrust his power to you, you must go through a test. One has fear. Lord Jesus Christ was the Son of God, but before his ministry would have started, before God would have given him power even to do a single miracle, he was tested first. Praise God. He was tested. He underwent tests in life. In his life, you can see that he was even complaining. He has nowhere to put his head. Praise God. It means that he was undergoing things that at times drained him completely. That man that is sent before you undergoes such tests. It doesn't mean that his mission is only to lead you to your promised land. Because in his calling, yes, he's higher than you. There is also a reward for him. One has a feeling. Do you want to be a man sent before another's life? Do you desire to be that? Praise God.
Amen.
Do you desire to be that?
Yes.
Do you desire to be a destiny helper of somebody?
Yes.
Do you desire to be an intercessor of somebody?
Yes.
Be prepared for the test of time. Be prepared to be squeezed. When you look at the story of Joseph, number one, he was hated by his brothers without cause. He was sold as a slave by the same people of his household. One has feared. In slavery, in a strange land, he was accused falsely, sent to the prison. He underwent so many things until again when God brought him out of that. Praise God.
Amen.
You may be going in tough situations, maybe. It may be that you are a destiny helper of somebody. And I believe that every one of us here is somebody's destiny helper. Amen?
Amen.
God never makes anyone who is independent. You may be a destiny helper of your family. You may be a destiny helper of this church. You may be coming every Sunday here. You don't preach. You don't near the pulpit. You may despise yourself, but you never know that you may be the destiny helper of this ministry. Praise God.
Amen.
You may be the destiny helper of somebody else. This church, as we are stationed here, may be a destiny helper of another church that is in this area. Amen. God has a divine purpose for everything as it happens in our lives. The destiny helper, the intercessor, that man who was sent ahead, must undergo situations that, number one, will make him bow down to his own powers. I mean to look down upon his own powers or his own ability. That is one thing that happens to the life of a destiny helper. God will create a situation in his life whereby you will see that he is completely useless or powerless in terms of his ability. Meaning that he'll have only to depend on the power of God in his life. Praise God.
Amen.
If you ask ministers of the gospel, they will tell you that it reached a point whereby they were giving up. I was surprised. I was looking at a man of God, a great man of God, on TV, and he was giving his testimony. He was saying that it reached a point in his ministry whereby he was contemplating to commit suicide. What happened? If God promised you, you knew that your ministry will be like this, what made you to get to that point of wanting to commit suicide? One has a fear. And again, I realized that it is a point whereby God has to push you to the wall so that you know that you can't do it with your ability. You can't be a destiny helper when you trust in your own power. Praise God.
Amen.
Because otherwise, you'll miss the mark. Otherwise, God will not be part of it. And the divine purpose that God has preordained for you will not come to pass. Amen?
Amen.
Do we believe in the power of God?
Yes.
Do we shut down our ability?
Yes.
Yeah. For you to be a destiny helper, you have to see these things manifest in your life. And my brothers, I just want to give you an encouragement that if you have been selected as a destiny helper, there is nothing that you can do to avoid that calling. If you avoid it, maybe you'll die and go to hell. But if you are to fulfill that, you must undergo that test whereby you will lose the trust in your own power. It depends on how you believe. If you tend to be tough, God will bring more and more numerous tests in your life to the point whereby you'll shut down your power. Amen. That is the point where Apostle Paul was speaking of. I have shut down everything. I've rendered everything as useless for the sake of the gospel. That is the point that a deliverer, a servant of God, must come to reach. Praise God.
Amen.
For you to fulfill the purpose of God in your life. David was here, and as we see here, when he was asked, "You're a young boy, how do you believe that you'll take down this giant?" I was seeing here doubt in them. They were hopeful, and again they had doubt. They want anybody who will save them in that situation. But again, they have doubt if this person was laid up himself to be used as a savior. They're saying that, how will we know? How are you sure that you will fight him? But we see here David saying that in the past, God delivered me from the bear and from the lion. Praise God. So we see that it was a point in life when David knew that maybe his weapons, when he was looking at his father's flock, would not be enough to scare away a lion. So he only hoped in the power of God, which strengthened him and enabled him to take down the lion. And that elevated him. That is what happens in the life of a deliverer, in the life of a destiny helper, in the life of that man that has been sent ahead of you. The tests that you undergo are meant to be a testimony in your life. One has here. How many hardships are you going through as at this time? Is there anybody here who is living a smooth life without any hardships? Praise God. Is there anyone? There is none. So I believe that all of us are destiny helpers of other people. Amen? Amen. So when you endure all this, it becomes a testimony in your life. At times it may be really bitter. Praise God. At times it may be really bitter. I remember a few years back, there's a day that I was so broke. I was broke back at the machine in the house. I don't have even a single coin. So in the morning, nimeamka niko na waza tu. I'm undergoing all this and I'm saved. Back at my office, what is really happening in my life? Sijaokoka vizuri, ni dhambi ama ni nini? So nikiwaza hivyo, a brother called me. Kaniuliza, how are you? I like him, mwambia I'm fine. Bwana asifiwe. Ili nifunike tu, mwambia I'm fine. But in the real sense, I was not fine. I don't have a coin in my pocket and I have a family. So nikiwaza hivyo, kaniambia, hey, you are fine. Kasema, yes. I was surprised on the next one that he said. Then he said that I can see that God has squeezed you down financially. I was really surprised. I'm undergoing all this, but it's God who is doing it. I was really shocked. Even in his support, I'm saved. Mungu mwenye anakufinya ukose hiyo pesa. But I encourage you to be of good cheer. It is working together for your good. Amen?
Amen.
So if you are a destiny helper of somebody, be prepared to pass through tough times. And the Bible says that we have to give thanks to God for everything in our lives. Because we are saved. It's only to those who are saved. If you are not saved, I find you accept everything. But if you are saved, you have to accept everything as it comes. Even if you are downpressed, umefidiliwa, encourage yourself before God, saying that I'm going nikona pitia hizi for a deliverance of somebody who is behind me. I may be knowing him or not. It may be my family, my ministry, or a brother. But I know that it is working together for his good. But I'm going also to get a reward.
Amen.
So, what happened here in the case of David? He gave them his testimony. God did this and this. And I believe in this God, he will also do that to me. Bwana asifiwe. Our pastor and his mama pa aseme, I'm seeing this and this will happen in your life. But be of good cheer because there is a time that I also underwent the same thing and God delivered me. What is happening there is showing you that there is a supreme power that can work a way out of your life. As at that time, you may not have the ability to comprehend what he's saying. You may be having doubts in your mind. But I want to assure you today that as you are waiting upon God, he who has promised the promised land, he shall surely make it come to pass. Amen? The Bible says, commit your ways unto him, and he shall make it come to pass. When you read the story down, you see what happened. He was given the armor of Saul, the highest man, I believe, of all the army of Israel. The best armor was of Saul because he was the king. Maybe kama zao wengine zilikuwa ni za nitasema aluminium. Aluminium is not a strong metal, yeah? So nitasema armor zao wengine was aluminium. I believe that your soul ilikuwa steel. Praise God. I believe that it was stronger, superior than zao wengine because he was the king. Who was to be protected at all costs. Praise God. But we see that even after being given this armor, he will not move with them. I can believe that I'm fooling. Maybe I'm fooling Kama John. And the armor you got, yeah, Pastor Tom. So I got a Kivan Dani in Kama Zimamfina. So he will not be able to move. And again, he says that, no, I just have to go the way that I am. Praise God. Amen. At times when we are given advice by our destiny helpers, by our spiritual fathers, our pastors, when we are given direction by them, it may look foolish. It may look of no sense. You may look at it with your natural mind, one apana. Even though we are saved, even though we are believing in God, the way that you are doing it, it requires wisdom. One has feared. But in the real sense, the wisdom of God is not our wisdom. One has feared. The wisdom of God is not our wisdom. His ways are not our ways. One has feared. You can believe that for you to own a big house, you have to have money. Yet God has sent somebody there to build that house for you, then occupy you for more. One has feared. You may believe that for you to be a powerful man of God, you have to fly from here to Europe. When you kind of in a jakes, in the jakes, maybe you can be now, you wanted that power, but you can still get that power here where you are. One has feared. Because God has put a destiny helper. If that helper is in Europe, I assure you that when the appointed time comes, God will cause you to go to Europe, or will cause that man to come to Africa so that that power can be imparted unto your life. Amen? It is all about the appointed time. It's all about that man that God has sent before you. What happens at the end? You see that David went there and threw just a little stone. He used that little stone and he brought deliverance unto the children of Israel. One has feared. Because the appointed time had come, the deliverer, who was David, came to the point of contact with these people at the time that they were mostly desperate. And victory came to the land of Israel. One has feared. You may have prayed unto God for a long time. You may have waited upon God for a long time. Though it tarries, it shall surely come to pass. Praise God. God may have given you a promise. And I like our pastor the way he speaks. He always speaks like this. And it's the same that God has given you a promise. God has shown you something. But he always says that it may take one day, it may take 1 year, it may take 5 or 10 years, or it may take 20 years, or even your lifetime to attain that which God has promised you. One has feared. Why? Because there is an appointed time for everything under the sun. Praise God. The preacher says that there is time and season for everything. One has feared. So it is an encouragement unto us this afternoon that for what God has promised unto us, for what God has preordained for us, there is always an appointed time. There is nothing we can do to move to that promise or that promised land by our own efforts. Remember that it is God who ordained it and is the one who is planning it to make it come to pass. One has feared. If you are living in your house and you plan that Leo, Ndakula, Hiki na Hiki, your child will not know. Maybe utawambia tu Leo, utawapikia kuku. He will not want to know how to go, where to get it, but he will have that faith. Leo, Dadi au Mami akisema, utakula hii. Praise God. So he will wait, or she will wait, mpaka ifike hiyo saa, then wataikula. Maybe kama itakuwa ndio atauliza, Dadi, you say this, but what happened? Praise God. We should be like children. We should be like that because God is our Father. When He promises something, we must have that faith, which is the substance of that thing which God has promised unto us. Praise God. Amen. So, we shall rise and I shall give us a chance. We shall go before God and we shall pray in this manner. Number one, we shall thank Him. for what He has promised in our lives. Try to remember anything that God has promised in your life. Maybe you dreamt and it was interpreted. Maybe He spoke to you through visions. Maybe He spoke to your ear, your third ear. Maybe He revealed that to you. And you are very sure that God said that. We shall go before God and say and thank Him. Thank God that you have designed this in my life. Thank you because you said this and this. Thank you because you promised this to our ministry. Thank you because you have promised this. And then you say that, I know that you are making it come to pass. Amen. You shall just remind Him, God, you say this, I believe you are fulfilling it. Amen. That is how we shall pray to God today. Because I believe that God is making a way in our lives. Amen. We shall all rise. We shall sing a song meditatively. And as you sing this song, meditate upon the promises of God in your life. The promises of God in this ministry. The promises of God that you have ever had. If you have ever had God promising something in this ministry, remind Him. Maybe you say that this ministry will be like this and this. I know that you're fulfilling it in your appointed time.
Amen.
And in those lines, you can also ask God to give you the spirit of long-suffering, of humility, the spirit of patience, waiting upon God. Because it takes that long-suffering and patience for the fulfillment of God's promises in our life. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say what you say. We believe that God, you know the end from the beginning. before he called us, he knew the end of our enemies. Before he manifested us under the sun, Jehovah, he knew our end. And he called abortion today, my new father. Remind you of the promises that you have in your life. And remind you of the promises that you have given and intend to Jehovah. He said that this ministry is like a natural ministry. He said that Jehovah is a user. To change the life of people worldwide. I know that my true father, you are manifesting it. You are manifesting it as a physical, according to your appointed time, in the name of Jesus Christ. My true father, you say that it is a divine for us. My true father, you say that you shall lift us in a mighty way. You are Lord, you promise that we shall manifest the gift of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. This is our Jehovah. I pray that my true father, according to your appointed time, release this gift to Jehovah.
Fulfill every promise that you gave to us, because you are God who does not change. You remain the same, Lord Jesus Christ. You are not like man to tell a lie. You are a faithful God who says and does what you say. You promise and fulfill your promises. And therefore, Father, we ask you today, by your grace and by your love, Lord, fulfill the promises you've given unto us, Lord. Father, now and forever, Lord Jesus, we shall give praise and glory unto you, because your power endures forever. Bless each one of us, Lord Jesus. Touch us now. Lord Jesus, touch our lives, touch our minds, touch our souls, Lord Jesus. Touch our Kabo. Lord Jesus, every part of our bodies and our souls, we pray. Let the Spirit of God take full control. Lord, we shall walk in your presence, a people you have chosen, a people you have appointed. Thank you for this day. Thank you for your protection. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for speaking to us. Lord, we give you praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Saying the grace, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you.